Well, good morning. Good morning. We have been talking about emotions the last few weeks. And emotions can be a good thing. We need emotions. God gave us emotions. But we don't want emotions to dominate us. Emotions are part of the human experience. But how do we allow emotions into the car without handing over the keys to them? Emotions can take us many places. The highest of highs to the lowest of lows. And our emotions have a place in our life. We just don't want to be controlled by our emotions. My oldest daughter, Emma, started babysitting when she was a teenager. And I don't know about you, but I think little kids are just some of the funniest people in the world. I mean, they just do things and they make me laugh. I just think they're hilarious. And so when she babysits, oftentimes when she comes home, I might ask her, hey, did you have any good stories from your babysitting experience this time? And so there's one family friend of ours, a close family friend, awesome family. They often ask Emma to babysit. And just about every time that she babysits this particular family, she almost always has a story about their oldest son, specifically about his love of nature and his love of things that, well, let's just say it this way, his love of things that would probably make most of us scream. Most of us would not love, okay? For example, one time she was getting instructions from the parents, you know, what time to go to bed, what's for dinner, you know, all those things. And the son, who was about 5 at the time, came in and said, I'm gonna go catch a bird. And we were like, what? Who catches a bird, right? And so they were like, okay, buddy, you know, you go have fun. And then 5 minutes later, he comes back in with a red robin in hand, and he's caught a bird. I mean, it was unbelievable, unbelievable. He has no fear. She tells me when he goes over, or when she goes over, he'll oftentimes come up to her, hands cupped, Emma, guess what I've got? Only to have a spider or a worm or something of that nature, and he'll chase her around the house. Now, the best story that she told me was the one that she told me most recently, though, that he now has a new pet, and you'll never guess what his new pet is. A hissing cockroach. A hissing cockroach, that is his new pet. And for sure, he wanted to show Emma all about his new pet. And so he pulls it out and it's crawling on his arm and he's chasing her around the house. And finally, when he gets done chasing her, he says, Emma, do you want to see it crawl on my chest? And before she could even answer him, he's whipped his shirt off and his cockroach is crawling up his chest. And he says, I'm doing this for you, Emma. I'm doing this for you. What an awesome kid. I can truly say I have never met anyone quite like him. And I'm pretty sure he's destined to be the next Bear Grylls or Steve Irwin or somebody like that. Now, my guess is that most of you would probably identify more with my daughter than with our little friend. And I'll be honest with you, I identify more with our daughter in that situation than we do, because I don't want any part of those things, right? They kind of freak me out. I don't want anything to do with them. But at the same time, I am thoroughly impressed that this little boy has zero fear when it comes to things that make most of us scream, that make most of us squirm. And maybe he's figured something out. Are we on? We're on. Okay, great. There may be some of those things in our lives where fear may be justifiable. There may be a reason to fear, but we have no control over that in our lives. Fear, like things of life-threatening diseases. Maybe it's family drama. Oh man, when we go there, I don't know what she's gonna say. I don't know what he's gonna say. Questions that come to our mind. Am I good enough? And many more. But how do we balance this idea of fear between healthy fear and fear that cripples us sometimes? How do we allow fear in the car without giving fear the steering wheel? Well, we're gonna take a look this morning. And I think the first thing that we need to take a look at and identify is, what is fear? I mean, what causes that reaction in our lives? I mean, it might be easy to say, you know, spiders just look scary. Like, I just don't want spiders around me, right? It might be easy to say, I don't go in the ocean because I've watched too many episodes of Shark Week, right? I don't know what's underneath there. But I think the reality is that the same thing that produces fear in our lives is the same thing that allows us to be creative. It's our imagination. And our imagination allows us to dream. And from that creativity and then from that dreaming, we're able to project what the future might look like. And sometimes it's awesome. And sometimes we go, I can't wait to get there. But that same imagination can also produce endless amounts of what ifs. And it can make our minds run wild asking that question and asking these different kinds of questions. What if I don't get that job? What if I fail? What if the cancer comes back? What if I never get to the place that I want to be in life? And really, I think the bottom line of our fears is this, is that we don't know what's going to happen next. And when we don't know what's going to happen next, that can be a scary place for a lot of us. And sometimes when we don't know what's going to happen next, we start coming up with all kinds of different scenarios in our minds. There is a place for fear in our lives, but we don't want to let fear drive the car, because when we let fear drive the car, many times it will take us places that we do not want to go. And what about the Bible? What does the Bible have to say about fear? Does it say anything about fear? Well, it actually has a lot to say about it. 365 times in Scripture, the Bible mentions this phrase in some way, shape, or form, fear not. And Jesus would spend a great amount of his time in his ministry trying to teach the disciples about fear and about how to handle it appropriately. And many times, the disciples would be in a situation where it seems like fear would be the correct response, only to hear Jesus say, fear not. Fear not. Stop being afraid. And in those moments when we are in situations where it seems like fear is the right response, that doesn't seem all that helpful, does it? It doesn't even really seem to make sense in that situation. Why should I fear not when clearly there is something to fear? So what did Jesus even mean when he said, fear not? And is it even possible in our lives? Well, if it seems hard for us to understand, just know that it was something that would take the disciples years to fully comprehend. And so this morning, I want to take a little journey through the disciples' path in learning about fear. And so one time he gathers all 12 of them together, and he gathers them in close, and he says something along these lines, that you are going to be sent out like sheep unto wolves. Comforting, right? Now today we use that term, and we just use it as a phrase. We just use it as a saying. But for those guys who lived in a culture where sheep and shepherds kind of were part of what was happening, they had seen what happens when a wolf gets to the sheep. And it wasn't pretty. Like, seriously, Jesus? I mean, this is what you're calling us to? This isn't what I signed up for when you asked me to come follow you. But he goes on, and it gets even better, and he tells them, you're going to be beaten. You're going to be arrested. This life that I'm calling you to isn't going to be easy. And then he follows with these words of encouragement saying, don't be afraid. So they're looking at each other. Did we miss something? like those things that Jesus just talked about, that's the very definition of what you should be afraid of. And he's telling us not to be afraid. What do we do with that? Now, a little bit earlier, Jesus was trying to teach them about fear. And he takes them on a little trip. And so we're going to go to the book of Matthew. And we're going to take a look here. And it's a story that you probably have heard before. But maybe there's parts of it that, because we've read it so many times, we've heard it so many times, there may be parts of it that we've missed. So in Matthew chapter 8, starting at verse 23, it says this. Then he got into the boat. Jesus got into the boat. And his disciples followed him. Suddenly, a furious storm came upon the lake so that the waves swept over the boat. But Jesus was sleeping. The disciples went and woke him, saying, Lord, save us, we're going to drown. And he replied, you of little faith, why are you so afraid? And then he got up and he rebuked the winds and the waves, and it was completely calm. And the men were amazed, and they asked, what kind of man is this? Even the winds and the waves obey him. So let's pause right there for just a moment, because I think we need to understand a few things right off the bat. When Jesus got in the boat, the disciples were immediately afraid. They were immediately afraid because to the Jews, the sea was known as the abyss. It was a metaphor that was used for hell. They didn't know what was out there in the deep. They didn't know what was out there in the middle of the sea. And some of you are thinking, well, weren't some of those guys fishermen? They were. But they would only go 50, maybe at the most 100 yards offshore to fish. They didn't go out where it was deep if they could avoid it at any cost. And so they're already scared just getting in the boat when Jesus said, we're going to go to the other side. And then a storm comes up. And the text says it was a furious storm. And I don't know if you've ever been on the boat, on a ship, in the middle of the lake or the ocean when a storm comes up. I haven't, but I've seen enough shows on TV to know I don't want any part of it, right? Waves crashing over the bow. And somehow, Jesus is sleeping through all of it. And the disciples go and they wake him up because they are terrified. They think they're going to drown. They're in the middle of the sea where the abyss is. And they have reason to be afraid in that moment. And Jesus gets up and he calms the storm, right? Now, when I've read that story when I was younger, I don't know why, but it was always like this peaceful thing. Like Jesus would get up on the boat and spread his arms and peace be with you, you know. But I don't think that's what it was. That's not what the text says, right? There was a furious storm going on. Thunder is clapping. The wind is blowing. The waves are crashing. And he looks at the disciples and he says, why are you afraid? And then he looks at the storm and he says, be quiet. And in that moment, everything is at peace. And then the disciples ask this important question. And maybe this is the thing that we've missed in the past because we've read this story so many times or we've heard this story so many times. And they say this, what kind of man is this? Even the winds and the waves obey him. Is this the Son of God? But why do they ask that question? Jesus feeds 5,000 people, they don't say that. Jesus raises the dead, they don't say that. Why when he stills the storm, do they ask that question? Because Jesus knew the disciples were good Jewish boys who knew their Bible. And he connects it back to the Psalms 107. He makes the connection. Starting in verse 28, it says, they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he brought them out of their distress. He stilled the storm to a whisper. The waves of the sea were hushed. They were glad when it grew calm, and he guided them to their desired haven. Sometimes I think here in America, from our Western cultural perspective, we think, yeah, wouldn't it have just been easier if Jesus walked up to the disciples, slammed his staff in the ground, and said, I'm God. And now you know. Right? Because that's kind of how we are in Western culture. We speak the truth. But Jesus does something different because he knew that in Jewish culture, showing was way more powerful than words. And Jesus was trying to teach them by connecting back to what would have been their Bible, our Old Testament. And he says through that story, here's the connection, I am God, and you don't have to fear. And maybe now they were starting to understand just a little bit. They were beginning to realize who was in the boat with them. And the fear that they had of the storm was being replaced with the fear of knowing that God was right there with them. And it had to be an eye-opening moment. Like, whoa, 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 whoa. Who is this man? I mean, are we standing next to God? Can you imagine the tension that the disciples had to be feeling in that moment to realize God is standing right next to me? And Jesus was trying to teach them, you don't have to let your fears overwhelm you. There's something more powerful than the storm, and it's right here with you. And so they continue on in their journey. And a few chapters later, Jesus comes back to this idea of fear. And so in Matthew 10, 28, he says this, do not be afraid of those who cannot kill the body, but do not be afraid of those who can kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in heaven. And Jesus comes back to this idea that we shouldn't be afraid of those things that can kill the body, but that our fear, or maybe a better way to put it, our respect, our awe, our reverence, should be in the one who has control and power over everything. And we all know and understand this, I think, even if we don't know how to put it into words, that there's more to us than just this body, that there is a soul that continues on after our time on earth is done. And our life, while it is a gift, and I do believe that it is a gift, I believe that Jesus gave us this life, and he says in his word that he came so that we could have life and have it to the fullest and have it abundantly and have it free. But in the grand scheme of things, even though this life is a gift, in the grand scheme of eternity, it's but a snap of the fingers. And Jesus says, I mean, if you're going to fear something, if you're going to fear someone, fear the one who has the power to calm the storm, the one who has power over everything. And when they were on the boat and the storm came up, they feared the wrong thing. I mean, don't get me wrong. They had reason to fear. They thought they were going to drown, but there was something more powerful than even the storm. It was the one who was there with them who could calm the storm. And Jesus goes on teaching them about fear because he wants them to understand something profound about his power. And he goes on in verse 29 and he says, are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside your Father's care. And even the very hairs of your head are numbered. So don't be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. I mean, these little birds that nobody even really cares about. You can go down to the market and you can buy a couple of them for pennies. And yet your heavenly Father even cares about these. And if he cares about these birds that seem worthless to most, how much more does he care about you? You're worth way more than sparrows. And he reminds us again that there's no need to be afraid. And then he tells them they are valuable. And he goes on and he makes it personal. He says, he knows how many hairs are numbered on your head. And I get it. That's easier for some of us than for others. But we need to understand the power of that statement, that if Jesus knows the details like that of our lives, you can be sure that he knows the big things that are going on in your life. He knows the hard and difficult things that are going on in your life. He knows the heartbreaking things that are going on in your life. And all those things can overwhelm us with fear. And when the storms of life come, Jesus says you can trust him and be certain that he cares. Well, later on, we find the disciples in a boat again, in the middle of the sea. Only this time Jesus was not with them. He had sent them out on their own. He had gone up to the mountain to pray, and he said, I will join you later. And so here they are again, in the middle of the lake, a place they do not want to be, a place that they are fearful of, and they're scared. And another storm blows in. And then, as they're sitting there, off in the distance, they see what looks like a ghost coming towards them.
great.
Here we are. We're in the middle of the sea. The waves are crashing over the boat. And now there's a ghost coming towards us. Could this day get any worse? But as the ghost gets closer, they hear a familiar voice that says, "Do not fear. Take courage. It is I." And I imagine in the midst of that storm, they're probably looking, wait, what did he say? Was that Jesus? It sounded like Jesus, but they're still not sure. And then Peter speaks up and he says, "Lord, if it's you, call me out on the water with you." And we know how that story goes, right? Jesus calls him out, and for a brief moment, Peter walks on the water with Jesus. And we pick that story up in Matthew 14, and it says this, that then Peter got down out of the boat. He walked on water, and he came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, cried out, "Lord, save me." And immediately Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" And what happens in that moment? For a few seconds, Peter forgets his troubles. He forgets the storm, and he walks on water with Jesus. But why does he start to sink? He starts to sink because he took his eyes off of Jesus, the one who had all the power. And he put his focus on his fears and on the storm and all the things that were around him. And many times we do the exact same thing in our lives, don't we? Jesus is walking with us through every storm of our life, which he always promises to do. He's right there beside us, walking on the waves. And instead of us revering the one who walks on water, the one who calms the storm, our eyes begin to shift to the storm, and our fears begin to overwhelm us like the waves crashing over those boats. See, Jesus spends years trying to get his disciples to understand this idea that they don't have to be afraid. And ultimately, they wouldn't get it until the last days of Jesus' life. Because in those final days, we know that Jesus is arrested and the disciples don't know what to do. They panic, they run, they hide. And the disciples are right back where they began, consumed with fear. But then something happens that changes everything. Because they watched Jesus be crucified. They watched him die and take his last breath. They watched his body carried off, and they saw the tomb sealed. But then on the third day, he rose again from the dead. And the disciples are reunited with Jesus once again. And it's at this point in the story that I think they truly start to get it. That everything that Jesus had ever taught them was starting to make sense. It was all coming together now. Because now he had defeated death. And what is there left to fear when death has been defeated? Now, yes, this world would continue to be a scary place for these guys as they would continue on and they would travel and they would spread his message, because many of them would be imprisoned. Many of them would be beaten. Many of them lose their own lives, just as Jesus had told them early on. But they weren't consumed with fear any longer, because now they had the confidence of the one who holds the future. There was more to this life, and they knew it now, and they finally got it. "Fear not, for I am with you." And when those disciples were able to put their fears aside and put their trust in the one who calms the storm, they literally changed the world. And I believe that when we don't allow our fears to control us and consume us, and we put our attention and our focus on Jesus instead of the storms that may surround us in our lives, that our lives too will be changed. When we get to a point in our journey, when we no longer let fear drive the car, it is then that we can truly begin to live. Because when we worship a risen Savior, when we worship someone who has mastered life and defeated death, and when he says, "Fear not," you begin to realize, I can live my life without fear. Not because there's not anything to be afraid of in this world, but because we can trust the one who has conquered death and promises to be with me every step of the way. Years later, Peter would continue to point us in the right direction. The same Peter who lost faith and sank in the water. The same Peter who panics when Jesus is arrested and cuts a Roman soldier's ear off. The same Peter who doubted even knowing who Jesus was. That same Peter would remind us in a letter that he would write to the Christians who were being persecuted for their faith, where life was difficult, and he says this, "Cast all your cares, all your anxieties, all your worries, all your fears, cast all your cares on him because he cares for you." And Peter speaks from experience. He says, "I've been there. I've walked with the man. I've seen him calm the storm. And even though I didn't always get it right, I can tell you, he is who he says he is, and he cares for you." You can put all your fear at the feet of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. And so maybe today that's the invitation, to cast all of our cares on him. To give up our fears, whatever it is that's causing us fear, whatever it is that's keeping us up late at night, whatever it is that's causing us anxiety and stress and worry or uncertainty, Jesus says, "Fear not. I am with you." So as we close this morning, we want to give you time to respond to the invitation that Jesus offers. That if you want to go to one of the tables that are around this room, and maybe you want to cast your cares at the feet of Jesus by writing it out on a piece of paper and pinning it to the cross and leaving it there. And I'm not just talking about leaving the piece of paper there. Because we do that all the time, right? We come to an altar, we pray, we say, "Jesus, I want you to take this." And we get up and we leave and we take that thing right back with us. But that you can write out whatever that fear is. And you can pin it to a cross, and you can leave it there. And it would be our privilege as a staff to pray with you, alongside with you, throughout this week. Maybe you want to go and you want to light a candle as a way to ask Jesus to light your path, because light has a way of bringing things to the light, and the dark is a scary place sometimes. And maybe we ask Jesus to put a light in that darkness of fear in your life. Or maybe you want to take communion this morning as a way to thank Jesus that he has already overcome death, and so I do not have to fear any longer. Would you pray with me, and then you can respond as the Lord leads you. Jesus, sometimes this world is a scary place. If we're honest, many times this world is a scary place. And you tell us over and over again, as you share with the disciples and the examples that you give us there, you say, "Fear not, I am with you." Not because there's not anything to be afraid of, but that we have you with us who has power and control over all. And so this morning, Jesus, if there is anything in our lives that is consuming us with fear, may we give it over to you. May we trust the words of Peter that we can cast it all to you. Cast all of our worries, all our fears, all our cares on you because you care for us. May it be so this morning. We love you. We ask these things in your name. Amen.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me.
That you'll know and sense that truth this week, that fear doesn't have to have the last word. You can go and God will go with you. We're so grateful that you decided to join together with us. However it is that you find yourself throughout this week, we pray that you'll be reminded over and over again of a God that's for you, has the best in mind for you, and that you will be light in this world and that fear won't have a hold on you. Thanks for joining us today. We'll see you next time.
Thanks so much for joining us today. If you love the content you heard and you'd like to know when the new content becomes available, scroll down and like and subscribe to our channel. Again, thanks so much for being here today, and we can't wait to see you next week.